you've been following along in the story, you know that the chapter for this week is called The Fate of a Foreign Woman. Our story this morning takes us back to the days of the judges. A time, as we saw last Sunday, which had some highlights, but also had a lot of troubles. A time when Israel was caught in a cycle of sin, oppression, repentance, deliverance, and then sin again. But in the midst of this time, the time of the judges, there is a beautiful story, a story of love, of redemption, and of hope. The story begins with tragedy, however. Elimelech and his wife Naomi were living in Bethlehem with their two sons when a famine hits their farm. So the family moves to Moab to survive, and there the two boys grow up and eventually married. One married Orpah, and the other married a young woman named Ruth. Then Elimelech and each son in succession get sick and dies. Devastated, the widow Naomi decides to go back home to Bethlehem. Orpah, at Naomi's insistence, goes back to her family. But Ruth will not leave Naomi alone. Instead, she pledges to give her life to Naomi. Once home, the tragedies start to become blessings. Our scripture this morning is in Ruth chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. And after I have finished reading, I invite you to imagine yourself just for a few moments as wedding guests, sitting down at the feast at the reception in a little village of Bethlehem. This is Ruth chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. One day, Ruth's mother-in-law Naomi said to her, "My daughter, I must find a home for you, where you will be well provided for. Now Boaz, with whose women you have worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfume, and get dressed in your best clothes. Then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, note the place where he is lying. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do." "I will do whatever you say," Ruth answered. So she went to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking and was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth quietly approached, uncovering his feet, and lay down. In the middle of the night, something startled the man. He turned, and there was a woman lying at his feet. "Who are you?" he asked. "I am your servant, Ruth," she said. "Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are a guardian redeemer of our family." "The Lord bless you, my daughter," he replied. "This kindness is greater than that which you have shown earlier. You have not run after the younger men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All the people in my town will know that you are a woman of noble character." May God add a blessing to the reading of this word.
Thank you. and sharing this wonderful moment for Ruth and I. Having family and friends celebrate our wedding with us just makes the day perfect for us. Second of all, for all of you out there who said that Boaz would be the perpetual bachelor of Bethlehem, well, I guess I've showed you, haven't I? I admit, I never had any plans to marry. I was happy to run my farm. I was happy to enjoy the evenings with the guys, but this woman has changed everything in my life for me. Naomi, I know life has been hard for you. When I saw you come back to town, you told us to call you Mara instead of Naomi. I couldn't believe it. I had no idea what could have happened to you, that you would choose a name or change a name that meant pleasant and happy to a name that meant bitter and hard. It was because you felt like God had abandoned you. And then I heard how you had lost Lohnes, Malon, and Kilian. And I know it was a difficult time, and I have no doubt that in bringing you into my family, I hope that you will find peace and happiness finally. I hope you will know what I've heard all those women up there saying. That I can't replace your son, but Ruth here has been to you better than seven sons could ever have been. And to my new wife, Ruth, what can I say? I'll never forget that day when I saw you gleaning out in the field, gathering up what was left of the little bit that my harvesters had left behind. But you were working so hard. You were new in town. You had that little bit of mysteriousness about you, the foreigner. When I saw you, I asked my man, who is that man? And I heard your story. It just immediately, you became to me one of the most beautiful people in the world. Not because of your warm eyes and your shiny hair, but because of your heart. You left your family. You left your home. You left everything that you knew to come to this land where you would not only be a stranger, but you would be a foreigner and a widow. You risk being an outcast simply because you loved your mother-in-law, would not let her live hopeless and helpless. And you put your faith and you put your trust in God even when Naomi was angry at God. I think you had enough faith for the two of you. Your care and your love and your faithfulness. That's the beauty that I have not seen very many other people. Not seen it very often at all. It's something that immediately drew me to you. It's why I wanted to protect you. I don't know if you really understood how vulnerable you were. It's why I had to command my men to watch out for you, to keep you safe as a widow in a foreign place. It was dangerous. I'm so glad you chose to stay in my family. Get to know each other. I can only imagine what Naomi must have said that first day when you brought home the harvest. You had enough to last a month or more. Do you remember what you said when I told you to harvest here? You said that I have made you a simple servant, feel so at home. You said, thank you for extending such grace. I don't really feel like I was the one giving grace. I feel like I was the one who was receiving grace and receiving blessings. I still feel like that. That night that you came to me, we're married now, so it's probably okay to tell the story, isn't it? It's a little sketchy, but a couple of weeks ago, the end of harvest, you should all know this, I guess. A couple of weeks ago, the end of harvest, the men and I, celebrating because our work was done for the season. We had drank well, we had eaten well, told a few stories. I was feeling pretty good. It was kind of getting late, and I hate to walk home in the dark and go into that empty house, so I just went out to the threshing floor, curled up in a corner, pulled pull the blanket up to my chin, lay down to have a good night's sleep. And then about, I don't know, about 3 o'clock in the morning, I woke up because my feet were cold. And I thought, how come my feet are sticking out from under the blanket? And then I went to roll over, and there was this woman. I mean, it wasn't in my bed, but it was on the threshing floor. There was a woman at my feet. I smelled this fragrant aroma. I had no idea who it was until I heard the voice. I said, "Who is it?" And you replied, "I'm Ruth, your servant." You asked me to put my blanket over you, to put my cloak over you, and to be the kinsman redeemer for your family. Now, I know some of your relatives are here today from Moab, and they might not understand all this kinsman redeemer stuff of our customs, but for you who haven't heard this before, a kinsman redeemer is a blood relative. So someone who steps up to care for someone in their vulnerable times. When an extended family member has gone on hard times and has gotten themselves into trouble, either financially or something else, a kinsman redeemer is someone who steps in to advocate for them, to care for them, to help them go. It's actually in our book of the law, it's in Moses' book of Leviticus, that we have a responsibility as family, though not an obligation. We have a responsibility that we should do it, but not the obligation that we have to do it. To look out for the needy in our tribe, in our family. And for us, it's a reflection of God's caring for us, of God who was our kinsman redeemer when he brought us out of Egypt and rescued us. Because God has done that for us, we should, no matter how close or how distant, we should look out for our family. Step up. It's always a choice, responsibility, but not an obligation. I was just so touched when you asked me. This old guy, older than you anyway, I won't tell him how old. And Ruth already knows this. There was actually somebody else who's a closer relative. It's another man in town. Actually, I think he's here today. He was supposed to be the one doing this. He wasn't supposed to be the one who was making this speech today, but I think God had it in mind for Ruth and I to be together. The day after that night that Ruth came to me, I went right to the town gate, and there he was. He was coming in. It was like God had just put it into place. He was coming in as I was going out, and I said, "I want you to stay right there. We have business to discuss." And I went out. I got 10 of the elders of the town. I said, "Come here, we need to get something straight. I want you to be witnesses between me and this other man about the business. So no one will be able to speak." And I told him, I said, "Hey, Naomi's back in town." But she knew that already. I said, "She's pretty poor. Her land is coming up for sale. And I know you have first right to buy it, to redeem it, if you want." He said, "Well, I can always use more land." I said, "Oh, just one little thing. If you buy this land, a couple of women that come with it, a couple of widows, Naomi's daughter-in-law, my Lohnes' widow, she'll have to become your wife too, because the land needs to stay in his name for his family, so she'll have to become your wife and you'll have kids." He said, "Well, I already got kids. And they ain't gonna let some foreign woman who won't even carry my name put my family's property at risk. You're next in line. You go right ahead and take it if you want. I'm not gonna risk it." And then to show everyone that he was giving me the land, that he gave me his sandal, pulled it right off his foot, handed it right off to me. It's kind of a symbolic way to say, you know, I give up my claim to it. And to you, I just want to say two things. I still got the sandal. It's very comfortable. You wouldn't by chance want to sell the other one, do you? And secondly, thank you. Thank you for rejecting the most wonderful person in the world and allowing her to become my wife. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. Then I said to the elders, "You saw it. I am buying the property of Elimelech and Chilion and Mahlon, and I take Ruth, the Moabite. Mahlon's widow as my wife. He promised to maintain his name. You all are witnesses to that. That kind of brings us today, isn't it? Thank you, dear elders, for your kind words to me earlier. Your blessing means a lot to Ruth and I. You said, may the Lord make the one who's coming to your home like Rachel and Leah, who together built the family of Israel. Well, I'm a bit older, you get married, but I like your enthusiasm telling me that you hope Ruth will have as many kids as Rachel and Leah. Jacob had 12. I'm not sure I can handle that, but I don't know if you're going to try. You say, may your family be like that of Perez, who was born to Tamar from Judah. I'm not quite sure why you would compare Ruth to Tamar, although I suppose she's a foreigner like Tamar was, and yet she was a faithful, honorable, God-loving woman. And you say, may you have standing and be famous throughout your upbringing, the most famous of that. Well, I don't know how famous I'll be. But I expect that anything that I have will be because I connected to this woman. Ruth, you are an honorable woman with a beautiful heart and a beautiful spirit. You've graciously asked me to be your husband, to be your redeemer. By God's grace, I will be the best husband I can be. I raise my glass to offer you a toast, to say I love you, and I will honor you and cherish you all the days of our lives. To me, the story of Ruth actually gives us two challenges, two questions that I think are there. First of all, how are we like Ruth? You know, like Ruth, we are all vulnerable. Some of us may be poor materially, but all of us are poor spiritually. All of us in some way need redemption. Paul said to Titus in chapter 2, verse 14, that Jesus Christ himself gave himself to redeem us from all wickedness, to make us a people who are his very own. That Jesus chose to be our kinsman redeemer. That he covered us not with a cloak or with his blanket, but with his own body as he hung on the cross. That Jesus loves us so much that he chose to die in our place that we might live. Can you believe that this morning? Can we believe it enough that we plant it into the deepest parts of our lives so that this truth of Christ's love and his redemption for us nurtures and feeds everything we ever say and everything we ever do? We can know that we are not just servants who are unlovable, that we are Christ beloved. He has chosen to be our kinsman redeemer. Secondly, how are we like Boaz? Who are the vulnerable in our lives? Who are the vulnerable in my sphere and where I travel? Who I can offer protection or help or... Because God has redeemed me, who can I extend God's love to? Not because I have to, but because I choose to. Not because I feel it must be an obligation, but because God's love has been poured into my life. You never know. When you extend God's love, you too might be a part of bringing Christ into this world in our time. Just like Ruth. The last verses of the book of Ruth are one of those boring genealogies. One of those lists of names that are kind of strange and that you never really want to read through. You always kind of skip through it. And yet, in these boring names, we might find a few names that we recognize. Turns out, Boaz's mom was Rahab. We met Rahab last week. She was the one from Jericho who save those two spies that Joshua had sent in. Boaz and Ruth had a son named Obed. They called Boaz Jr., they called him Obed. Obed married, and he had a son. His name was Jesse. Jesse, you might remember, was a father of 8 sons, the youngest of whom was a famous guy by the name of, probably the second most famous king, born in Bethlehem. A guy by the name of David. David, with his wife, had a son, and another son, and after that, until finally we come to the most famous king born in Bethlehem, Jesus. Jesus can do for us what God did for 2 widows in ancient Israel. He can take us from bitter to better to whole as he rescues us and as he redeems us because of his great love for you and for me. Let us pray. Father our God, we thank you this day. People like Boaz, Ruth, put faithfulness to you and kindness to others ahead of all. We are so grateful for this story of hope in the midst of a dark period in Israel's history. And we are so grateful today, Father, for Christ, who came in the dark moment of this world to offer light and hope. And we thank you, Father, that today you can pour and plant hope deeply within our hearts and our lives. And that is all. Help us, Father, to follow the examples of that which you have set for us, both in that beautiful couple of the Old Testament, that beautiful Savior that is ours today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.